Hopefully this will be a good revision for anyone who's missed the sessions on Curley's wife, or have missed when we were doing our annotations. But also, if you were there, it's a really good revision. So if we go straight into it and look at the first extract, wait till you'll see Curley's wife. So this is quite interesting. John Steinbeck has chosen to use this term. He could have said, wait till you see Vicky, or wait till you see Lucy, but he's decided to say Curley's wife. So the reason for this is that it shows to us that she's a possession. So the apostrophe here, the apostrophe of possession indicates that Curley's wife, she belongs to Curley. She's his possession, just like his horse, his hat, and his handgun. So it's showing us that that's how low, that's how she's seen by Curley and by the other men on the ranch, as just his belonging. So it's quite interesting, we could link it to Curley's glove full of Vaseline. So we can debate whether he actually needs to use the glove, or he actually does use the glove for touching his wife, but he actually wears it just as a status symbol to show the people on the ranch that that woman belongs to me. The second reason we could say that Steinbeck uses this is that her name, or lack of name, is a symbol for male oppression in 1930s America. Steinbeck himself said, she's not a person, she's a symbol. So I said, remember I said in previous lessons, to get really good marks, you have to link your controlled assessment back to the context, back to the Dust Bowl, back to the Great Depression. So basically Steinbeck is saying that she's a symbol for how women were being treated at that time, that they were just being seen as objects, or they were seen as people who were pretty, or just for men for cooking and for cleaning. So George cut the cards again and put out a solitaire lay, slowly and deliberately. So there's a couple of things I'd like to say about this part. One of the things is that solitaire basically means, the word solitary means lonely or alone. So this card game called solitaire, you play on your own. So that probably indicates to us that George is a bit of a lonely character. He has got Lenny. Lenny goes everywhere with him. But from a conversation point of view, he's probably not been able to talk too much to Lenny about how he feels about certain things because of Lenny's learning difficulties and disabilities. One thing I will say is that I will put photos and images up during this podcast if I can work out how to do it. Hopefully that will also guide you a little bit as well. So he plays the game slowly. We can also say about this, this probably shows us that George has played this card game probably hundreds and hundreds of times. So it tells us that he's been to loads of different ranches, that he's on his own quite a lot of the time. And deliberately probably also shows us that probably George is quite an intelligent character. So if you do something deliberately, you think about it, and that probably indicates, or Steinbeck is telling us, that George is an intelligent character. One thing I also want to go back to quickly about Curley's wife that I didn't mention earlier on is another reason we could say she's unnamed. So a theory you could put in your assignments is that everything that Lenny loves are soft. So Lenny loves soft things. We're told that right from the beginning of the novel. And everything that Lenny loves are unnamed. So rabbits, mice, puppy, and we could add Curley's wife to that list. So we could say that everything that Lenny loves are soft, they're all nameless, so can be added to that. Okay, so another reason why George may play solitaire a lot is that it gives him a chance to avoid conversation. So if you're playing a card game, people aren't really going to get you involved in conversation. It's also a barrier for him, so it means that he doesn't have to give eye contact to people, and he can just carry on with his sort of lonely existence. Because remember, we're told the American dream is of a case of everyone can, if you work hard enough, you'll get what you want. But by this stage, people were being disillusioned, and it was also almost every man out for himself. So straight away, Curley's wife is introduced as pretty, purty, or pretty. Yeah. So straight away, it's important to note that the only ways that she's brought up is sexually and physically. So they didn't begin the conversation by saying, well, she's got a cracking personality. Straight away, it's about how she looks. And then they say pretty, but. So straight away, we're getting negative thoughts, negative opinions about Curley's wife. So saying she's pretty, but. So we know there's something negative to come after that. Yeah, so straight away, through this little passage here, it's all about sexual and derogatory comments about Curley's wife. So she's got the eye, yeah, give Slim the eye, give Coulson the eye. So Coulson, just giving someone the eye again basically just means looking at different men in sort of a seductive or a sexually sort of attractiveness way. Okay, so here it says, yeah, she's married 2 weeks and got the eye. Maybe that's why Curly's pants is full of ants. So remember, that means that probably an old expression you heard when you were at school was ants in your pants. So it means if you're anxious. So basically they're saying here that she's looking at all these men, and that's why Curly's getting annoyed and anxious, because he's been married 2 weeks to someone and already they're looking at other men. Straight away down here, Candy, who is basically just been introduced to us, he says here, well, I think Curly's married a tart. So considering we've just met Candy, that's a very blunt thing and a very insulting thing to say about someone that we've never met. So an important thing to remember is that all of these things that we hear about Curly's wife, these are just rumours. So we are getting a biased opinion about this woman that we never met. She could be the most wonderful woman in the world, but we're just getting rumours from Candy. Remember, try to think of it maybe like, how would men or boys talk about girls in the locker room as opposed to if they were with a girl? So it's probably going to be a lot different. So try to keep that in your head, okay? So also in this part, Candy's got two roles. He is a guide. So he's a guide for George and Lenny. He's showing them the bunkhouse, where they sleep, where they're going to eat, all the different people. But he's also a guide for the reader. So he's introducing these characters. So we're getting a biased opinion from Candy. If we go into the next section, where we're actually going to start to meet Curly's wife. So both men glanced up, for the rectangle of sunshine in the doorway was cut off. A girl was standing there looking in. So what Steinbeck is using here is a metaphor. So the rectangle of sunshine. So sunshine is a metaphor for hopes and dreams. So we've already heard in the first chapter that George and Lenny have dreams of having their own land where they can feed, where Lenny can feed the rabbits, etc. So basically they're saying that when they're talking here, that it's full of light and sunshine and full of hope. But Curly's wife cut this off. So Curly's wife is the darkness that is going to erase their sunshine. In other words, Curly's wife is going to be the person who stops their dream. She is going to block this. So it's important to say that Steinbeck uses metaphors. Okay. So she had full rouge lips and wide space eyes, heavily made up. Her fingernails were red. Her hair hung in little rolled clusters like sausages. She wore a cotton dress and red mules, on the insteps of which were little bouquets of red ostrich feathers. So I would say 99.9% you are going to use this passage in your controlled assessment. So if we first of all go in and talk about the colour red. So she has rouge lips. Her fingernails are red. She wore red mules, on the insteps of which were red ostrich feathers. Okay. So first of all, we could say that she's using this colour to get attention, because it's obviously a very, you wouldn't see too many of these sort of things on a ranch in California at that time. But she's obviously doing it because she's trying to come across as attractive. So the connotations of the colour red, we could have things like sex, passion, danger, warning, blood. So all of these things are telling us that Curly's wife is a big, big warning sign for these guys, that it's going to be this person is going to cause trouble for them. She had full rouge lips, so she's wearing lipstick. So again, that's a sexual thing. Her fingernails were red. So again, that's another sexual thing. But also we could say about the fingernails were red. Perhaps John Steinbeck is foreshadowing that she will have blood on her hands. So maybe he's saying that she's going to cause trouble, or maybe literally she's going to have blood on her hands, that she's going to cause a death in some way. So we can say that she is culpable for Lenny's death at the end of the novella. I'll leave it up to you to decide how much you think she's responsible, if at all. She wore little red mules, on the insteps of which were little bouquets of red ostrich feathers. Okay, so we have talked about the red ostrich feathers before. But if you weren't there, I was basically saying the one thing you could say is that the person who would wear ostrich feathers probably in that time were movie actresses. So we know that Curly's wife and I'll try to put an image up as I'm speaking now. Curly's wife's dream was to become a movie actress. So she's trying to wear the same sort of things as her idols would have worn. So the thing is to note about this is she's wearing these tiny little ones on her shoes, while the picture I'm going to probably show you on the podcast is this woman's wearing absolutely massive ostrich feathers. So actually you can link that back to the context and say that she can only afford these tiny ones while the proper movie stars are wearing this massive, more expensive thing. So that shows the money. There wasn't a lot of money around at the time. The other thing I said about the ostrich feathers, sort of maybe a bit of a sort of a high level answer, was that the famous thing about ostriches are that they can't fly. They're a bird that can't fly. So you could say that this shows that Curley's wife can't fly. So she's got all these dreams, but she's not going to achieve them. That she is going to stay on this ranch, and there's no way that she's going to get to her dream of Hollywood. So she is a bird that is not able to fly. So I also want to go back and say the wide space eyes. So wide space eyes denotes or shows that someone is young, that someone is naive, someone is innocent. So heavily made up is another interesting choice that Steinbeck's made. So heavily made up, so it means that she's really, really trying, doing her best to look sexually attractive. Also, it may show that she's trying to look older. So remember, if you're like maybe if you're sort of a teenage girl, we think Curley's wife's about 18 or 19, she may be trying to look older so that the men find her more sexually attractive. Another thing we maybe could say, she's trying to hide a flaw. So maybe she has a physical flaw like a scar, or because she's a young girl, maybe she's got acne and she's trying to cover up her spots. But also maybe personality-wise, maybe she's trying to cover up a flaw. Maybe she's been hurt, not confident, so because of this, the makeup's making her feel more confident, trying to hide those psychological flaws. Another thing you could say, and remember a lot of this in your controlled assessment, you could say this suggests or perhaps. So this is not fact, this is just opinion. One thing you could say is perhaps it's covering up signs of domestic abuse. So we know that Curley is an aggressive man. He used to be a boxer. Whenever something comes up, the only way he responds to it is physically threatening or wanting to beat someone up, or in Lenny's case, going for revenge and trying to shoot him. So you could say that the makeup is trying to maybe hide signs of domestic abuse. Hair hung in little roll clusters like sausages. So this simile of sausages is not particularly flattering example. But it's quite interesting because this hair hung in rolled little clusters. At the time, this would have been a hairstyle that a child would have had, or a young teenager would have. So it's quite funny or quite interesting. You can comment on the fact that she's trying to use this lipstick, she's trying to use the makeup to make herself more adult, while in fact she does have a child's haircut. So the like sausages part is interesting. It's a simile. And perhaps you could say that the reason Steinbeck says it's like sausages is that all the men on the ranch see her or view her as a piece of meat. So they don't see her as a person, they just see her as a piece of meat. She wore a cotton house dress and red mules. So the cotton house dress, which hopefully you can see a photo of, is interesting for a couple of reasons. So one, a cotton is quite cheap. So you could again link that back to the contest, and you could say that was all that the ranch, even though they've got money, they won't have a lot of money, that's all they could afford. Another thing you can say is that cotton is soft. We know from chapter one, and I'll try to put the quote up as I'm speaking, we know from chapter one how Lenny feels about soft things. So Lenny absolutely loves petting and he absolutely loves soft things. So we know as readers there's a link. It's Lenny. Lenny likes soft things. Lenny pets the soft thing. And then Lenny ends up killing the soft thing. So we've had that with... We haven't had it yet, but we've had it with the dead mouse in chapter one. Then we have it with the puppy. And then eventually we have it with Curley's wife. And you could possibly say that this foreshadows Curley's wife's death. We've also had it from the girl in weed in chapter one. If you remember, the quote was, "Just wanted to feel that girl's dress. Just wanted to pet it like a mouse. Wanted to feel her dress." So we know immediately there's danger with Lenny touching soft things, and death will occur at the end of the novella because of that. I also want to go back up to the top a little bit, and the first description we have of her, where she's actually going to be in the room, is the word girl. Steinbeck has not introduced her as a woman, it's a girl. So immediately we think that she's probably going to be 18 or 19, and we probably think that she's going to have aspects that girls have. So she's going to be young, she's going to be naive. She's probably going to be wanting attention. She's probably going to do silly things. She's not a woman. She's not got a wise head on her shoulders. So we know that she's probably going to do immature things. To finally finish on the red, and remember basically that red equals danger. Okay? So I'm looking for Curley. She said her voice had a nasal, brittle quality. So nasal is probably also a sign of immaturity. So nasal voice perhaps could be someone a bit younger, but also it's not particularly flattering description. And the word brittle is quite interesting as well. So brittle means, it's like another negative thing. Brittle could mean weak. It could mean that something's going to break. So it could also mean that it shows that Curley's wife is a weak character and maybe she may break at some point. Oh, she put her hand behind her back and leaned against the door frame so that her body was thrown forward. You're the new fellas that just came, ain't you? So this description here basically shows that she's trying to use suggestive body language. So basically here she's just thrusting her breasts forward for the men to see. So it's another sexual thing that she's doing. You're the new fellas that just that came, ain't you? So this basically shows us that she's not particularly interested where Curley is. She's just wanting to know. And she's seen these new guys come in the bunkhouse and she's probably just interested to see what they're going to say. So Lenny's eyes move down over her body. So straight away, that this is another warning sign for the reader and for George, that Lenny is attracted to Curley's wife. So that's probably going to spell a bit of doom for various people. So she looked at her fingernails. So this is another thing where she's probably putting on a bit of an act. She's pretending like she's not particularly bothered, although she knows that Lenny's eyes are on her. So George said brusquely. So this is an adverb. So remember, an adjective that describes a verb. So this basically means blunt or abrupt. So basically, George is saying that he probably believes the rumours about her and he's not really interested in getting involved in the conversation with her. If he ain't, I better look someplace else, she said playfully. So another adverb, and this basically shows that it's a bit flirtatious. It's maybe a thing sort of a girl trying to get her interested. And it also shows us again that she's not particularly interested in finding Curley. So Lenny watched her fascinated. So we almost get an image of Lenny staring there with his mouth open with a little bit of dribble coming down, that he's totally fascinated by this woman and he's probably not seen too many people like her. She smiled archly and twitched her body. So here we just get a sense that she's absolutely loving the attention that Lenny is giving her, and that she's just enjoying the men looking and seeing how attractive she is. So then she says, nobody can't blame person for looking. So this is quite interesting because you could say it's a little bit of a statement with two exclamations for it. So one, she's saying that can't blame her for looking for her husband. It's fair enough. No one can say anything about that. But also it's saying that to the guys where, well, no one really can blame me for looking at me. Okay. So that's another thing where she's just trying to get attention throughout the novella. And in next few chapters, I will talk about why she needs the attention. Also, I will put the next sort of chapters up, the links in this video as well for you to look at. So Slim comes in and he says, hi, good looking. So this is the only time when anyone actually ever says anything to her that's pretty sort of complimentary in the whole of the novella, apart from when she's passed away and John Steinbeck and the animals actually ironically nice to her. So this isn't, we're not meant to take this as in Slim's particularly attracted to her. It's just a sort of a nice thing, a nice sort of polite thing, nice jokey thing to say to her. Also, Slim can talk to her in this way because he's the only one on the ranch who's not bothered or scared about losing their job or scared about Curley. He knows that he does his job well and he probably knows that the boss actually would probably believe him or trust him over his own son. It also shows us that Slim's a nice guy. Everything that Candy said about him is probably true. It also, at this time as well, it's quite sort of quite interesting that, for all we know, Slim could be having an affair with Curley's wife, because we don't really know Slim yet. But obviously, we come to realise that that's not the case. So when Slim says that I've just seen him going in the house, she's suddenly apprehensive. So apprehensive basically means worried or a little bit nervous. So basically, this is because she's realised that Curley's gone home and she's not there. So she should be in the house waiting for him to come home and waiting to cook his dinner. So basically she realises that and she knows she's got to go. She then says bye boys. So two sort of meanings. This one is she's saying boys bye boys in a little bit of a flirty way, but it also shows her age again, where she's not saying bye guys or bye sort of by their names, boys. It shows that she's a girl. So George then is pretty much sums up how he feels about her by saying, "Jesus, what a tramp." So this is one of many insults that's thrown away. And it shows that the vibe that Curley's wife is trying to give off is not being successful. She's trying to give off a vibe of an adult woman, a sexually attractive woman, an elegant, sophisticated wannabe actress, while in fact all the man just see is a tart, unfortunately. It also shows us that probably George is experienced. Now, though we know later on in the novella he hasn't got a girlfriend or a sweetheart, he's probably seen a lot of these women around on the ranch. And it's quite ironic, actually, that Curley's wife has actually even talked in a worse way than they speak about the prostitutes. They almost speak about the prostitutes and the woman who owns the brothel in a respectful way. And that probably shows where Curley's wife is in the pecking order. So again, Lenny says down here she's pretty defensively. So he's almost sort of defending Curley's wife, even though he doesn't know her. And again, that shows that he's attracted to her, and it's another warning sign to the reader that he's going to try and pet her, and because that's his way of showing attraction. And we know what happens to things that Lenny tries to pet, meaning they normally end up in the ground dead, unfortunately. So then George says she bet she'd clear out for $20. So again, that's a reference where she'd probably do anything for money. She'd probably leave for $20. Also, maybe sort of a prostitute reference where she probably actually would have sex with someone for that much. Gosh, he was pretty. He smelled admirably. So again, that adds to the idea that Lenny finds her absolutely gorgeous. And George then cuts down on this by saying, "Listen to me, you crazy bastard," he said fiercely. So that's another adverb that Steinbeck uses for George. And this basically shows us how strongly George feels about this, that he can almost see, like the reader can see, that this is going to end in trouble, and he's doing his best to make sure that that doesn't happen. So in this, he really sort of goes to town, a few different insults thrown at Curley's wife. So he calls her a bitch, which obviously is a horrendous term, but also the only other person who's called a bitch in the novella is Candy's dog. So that shows again how much they sort of view Curley's wife. So then she says they call him poison. So poison, remember, poison is something that you put down to kill someone. So George thinks that she's going to end up killing someone, so either kill them physically or kill their dream or just cause trouble. He then says he never seen any jailbait. So remember, jailbait is a girl who is not old enough to have sex and who is going to get a guy into trouble. And then it says here, Lenny tried to disengage his ear. So here we can say that George is trying to give Lenny a command about how to deal with Curley's wife. But Lenny, unfortunately, is just not taking it in. All he can probably see is the rouge lipstick, the hair, the wide-spaced eyes, the fact that he finds her attractive. And he can't take anything in that George is saying, that just leave it alone. So George is signposting here, or Steinbeck is signposting for us, as well as in the red descriptions earlier on in the chapter, that Curley's wife is trouble and he wants Lenny to stay away from her and vice versa. So he wants Curley's wife to stay away from Lenny and George. He then finishes by saying, "Well, you can keep away from her because she's a rat trap, if ever I've seen one." So again, the thing about George is telling us that this woman is going to end up killing them or killing their dream or at least affecting them in a dreadful way. He says, "You let Curley take the rap." He let himself in for it. So basically he's saying, you let Curley take all the problems and all the violence or all the trouble that's going to come. He let himself in for it. So because he married her, he should be the one who has to deal with it. My notes page on chapter 2 involving Curley's wife. So this is the stuff I've talked about, so I won't really go over it. I'll leave it up for a few seconds. So if you just pause the video and then you can copy down the notes, or at least just have a little bit of a look at it. So pause the video now and then I'll start scrolling down in a second. But hopefully this has been a good revision tool for you. We will go over in class the various things you need to put in your controlled assessment, but these will definitely give you some good points to put in there. So, and any problems, let me know. Thank you, bye. Chapter 3 of A Mice and Men, Relating to Curley's Wife. First thing to say about chapter 3 and Relating to Curley's Wife is that Curley's wife is not actually in this chapter, but she is discussed throughout. Curley's wife only appears 3 times in the novella. She appears when George and Lenny first arrive, she appears when she goes into Crookes' room, and she appears in her death scene. Steinbeck still makes her a dangerous lurking presence in the background, so even though she's not physically there, we still feel her presence. George dealt and Whit picked up his cards and examined them. "Seen the new kid yet?" he asked. "What kid?" So straight away, Steinbeck has used the word kid twice in 2 sentences. This is basically showing us what the other people on the ranch think of her. So it's quite interesting, the contrast between what Curley's wife wants the men to think. She wants to see them as sexually attractive woman, but they see her as a child. So, well, ain't she a Lulu? So Lulu, if you can't quite remember, we did talk about it in the class. So Lulu is a slang term sort of in the 1930s America for an attractive or pretty woman. Okay, so George says he hasn't seen that much of her, and then Whit says, "Well, stick around and keep your eyes open. You'll see plenty. She ain't concealing nothing. I never seen nobody like her. She got the eye going all the time on everybody. I bet she even gives stable bucks." So Crooks the eye. "I don't know what the hell she wants." So when it says she ain't concealing nothing, that could mean 2 things. It may mean that her clothing, so what she's wearing, is revealing. It might also mean that she's not concealing anything about her intention, so she's making it perfectly clear that she's flirting with these men. Also, "I never seen anybody like her" is Whit or Steinbeck telling us that this is something out of the ordinary, that all of the men have not seen too many people like Curley's wife. So down here we got Curley's got yellow jackets in his drawers. So yellow jacket means wasps, and it basically means wasps in your pants. So it's an old expression from 1930s America. So it's very similar to ants in your pants. It just means that Curley was very anxious. Whit then goes on to say she's looking for Curley, or she thought she left something laying around and she's looking for it. Seems like she can't keep away from guys, and Curley's pants is just crawling with ants, but there ain't nothing come of it yet. So we'll go back to yet in a second, but straight away we can see where it says she's looking for Curley, or she thought she left something laying around. Basically, this is the men saying that they know she's not looking for Curley. They know she's just using any old excuse to come and talk to them. She can't keep away from guys. So that's telling us, to reiterate him, that this is where she gets her attention from. She loves getting the attention from men. And we know that later on, this is all to do with her loneliness. She's desperately lonely, which we'll go on to see later in the following chapters. But also, it's interesting that we can actually see why Curley would have pants that are crawling with ants, so why he would be anxious. So if you think to yourself, if you married someone and 2 weeks later they were trying to flirt with any man or woman they could see, then we can see a little bit into Curley's sort of mind there and why he would be upset. So George said she's going to make a mess. Also, quickly, going back to the words yet, that's important because Whit is saying that nothing's happened, however they know. So the word yet is telling the audience, or foreshadowing to the audience, that they know something bad is going to happen, that something, this, all of these things revolving Curley's wife, is going to come to a head. There is going to be a climax, and it's not going to be pretty. So George said she's going to make a mess. They're going to be a bad mess about her. She's jail bait, all set on the trigger. That Curley got his work cut out for him. Ranch with a bunch of guys on it ain't no place for a girl, especially like her. So we know the word jailbait is another derogatory comment about her. Jailbait, again, is someone who's under the legal age for consent to have sex. But basically, we know Curley's wife's probably about 18 or 19. But the important thing is that it's a woman or a girl, or especially a girl, who's going to get a man into trouble. So where it says here she's a jailbait, all set on the trigger, if you imagine if someone's got their hand on the trigger, this is imagery for maybe killing someone. So if you put your hand on the trigger of a gun, you're going to shoot, you can definitely hurt someone, you're going to maybe even kill them. So figuratively, it may mean she's going to kill dreams or kill someone's hope, or literally it might mean, well, maybe she actually will kill someone. But later on, we do know that she's at least partly responsible for Lenny's death. Also, this bit is quite interesting here where it says ranch with a bunch of guys in it. Ain't No Place for a Girl. We can link it back to the context that women were seen as second-class citizens and they weren't really seen on the same level as men. And George is basically saying here that because it's a lot of men in the same environment, that a girl shouldn't be there. The especially like her part, though, actually changes the quote and again becomes an insult into Curley's wife. So George is basically saying, well, actually, it could be okay. It's not ideal, but it could be okay if it was, in quotes, a normal girl, but not for a tarty, flirty, or jailbait girl like they see Curley's wife to be. And also, again, this is the notion that all they do is see her as a girl. So she's trying to come across as a woman, but every single character, whenever they talk about her, they use the word girl to describe her. So again, showing how young they think she is, how naive they think she is. It's also important to note that they actually probably by this point just find her annoying. They don't want to lose their jobs. They don't want to get into trouble. So they just find her annoying. They don't really want any part of that. Carlson said casually, Curley been in yet? No, said Wit. What's eating on Curley? Blah, blah, blah. He spends his half time looking for her and the rest of the time she's looking for him. So interestingly, Curley and Curley's wife never meet in the novella apart from when she dies. So in life we never see them talk, we never see them interact. I know there's a scene in the movie where they interact, but you just got to forget that, because this isn't, we're not looking at the movie, we're looking at the novella. So you could say if they never meet, shows Timebeck is telling us how separate lives they lead. Yeah, so we're seeing all the difference between them. They never meet, we never get to see how they interact. We never get to see their house where they're having dinner at night, or see them when they're chatting at late at night around the fire or anything like that. We don't see them ever together, so that's important. And they do mention each other, but never in a pleasant way. So if Curley comes in, he's always annoyed because he's trying to find someone to be with his wife. When Curley's wife mentions her husband, it's normally that she's looking for him, or towards the latter part of the novella that she's criticizing him. She says he's a swell guy. She says that sarcastically. She even actually says, I wish someone would beat him up. She actually says, I don't like Curley. So it's just quite an amazing thing to say about someone you've married 2 weeks before. So we actually begin to think, why, if she doesn't want to see Curley, then why does she keep asking him? So one theory could be that she actually just wants to know where he is so she can avoid him. So if they say he's somewhere, then she can make sure she's not there. Also, she wants to know where he is because if he's gone back to the house, like actually does happen, she should be there cooking his dinner. So she doesn't want to get in trouble in terms of maybe she's scared that he might punch her or domestically abuse her. So again, we're getting, even though it's spelt out for us later on in the novella, we're beginning to realise with Curley's wife here that all she's doing is trying to get attention, that the flirting probably isn't that serious, but she's just cooped up in a house and she just wants some extra attention from the men. So that's chapter 3 basically done. So what I will do now is I will show you my notes page. So if you can copy some of this stuff into your extract, whatever you think is applicable. If you don't want to write some stuff down, you don't need to. It's whatever you think. Notes page. I will let you sort of read through it. So pause it. I will continue to sort of scroll down in a second. So pause whatever part you want. Add whatever you want to add. Leave whatever you want to leave. So that's it for chapter 3 of this podcast. Thanks for listening. And chapter 4 of Mice and Men, relating to Curley's wife. This is the chapter where Curley's wife goes into Crooks's room and she has a conversation with Crooks, Candy and Lenny. So this section, we're beginning to see a different side to Curley's wife. In this section we see a lonely side, a cruel side. But also in this section we see lots of different aspects of Curley's wife's character. We see flirtation, loneliness, how happy she is, danger, dreams, cruelty, and we see a bit more of context. Like I said, you want the good grades, you've got to mention context. So, any of you boys seen Curley? Okay, so straight away, we've gone into looking for Curley again, and the question. Curley's wife, one of her roles through the novella, is that she's constantly asking questions. A large part of her dialogue is questioning. Even more than Lenny. So Lenny is a character who basically doesn't really understand anything that is told or said to him apart from about the rabbits or meeting them in a bush if he gets in trouble. So we could then go on to say that Steinbeck is saying that she's a questionable character. So we as a reader have more question than answers about Curley's wife. We don't know her name. We don't know why she talks like she does. We don't know why she dresses like she does. We don't know how she feels about Curley. Even though we can have a guess at these things and we can assume things, we don't know for sure. She's a woman with no role. Her only role is Curley's wife. She doesn't have a job. She's not allowed. And we don't know too much about her previous life. We know a little bit, and we find out a little bit more in chapter 5, but we don't know a lot. Again, we said a thing about boys, which is slightly playful and slightly shows her age, that she's using the word boys. So it gets that she was heavily made up. So this is a very important point. Even though Curley and the men are out of town at a brothel, this is showing that she's still trying to get attention from anyone. So there's no possible way, well, it is a possible way, but it's very unlikely that she is attracted to Crooks, Candy, or Lenny. However, she's still trying to dress in a sexual way. She's still trying to get attention from anyone, which shows her loneliness. She has her eye on Lenny. Like I say, not for any sexual reason, but she knows from the earlier chapters, the earlier podcast, we know that Lenny is interested in her. He is her best option for getting the attention she wants. So she breathed, so her lips were slightly parted, she breathed strongly. So that's a little bit of a sexy, a little bit of a flirty vibe. But we could say maybe she's breathing strongly because she's a bit nervous. Maybe she's breathing strongly because maybe she's seen the guys go out of town, and maybe she looked through the window and she's run down to the barn because she ran down to Crooks' rooms because she's so desperate to speak to someone. One thing we've got to remember is at this point that Curley's wife, her husband, after 2 weeks of marriage, has gone to a brothel to sleep with prostitutes. So we've got to remember that a lot of people were saying she's a bitch, a lot of people saying she's a tsar who deserves what she gets, and maybe you even think that. But remember, she's a girl not older than 19. She's well out of her depth with a husband who is horrible to her, and a place she doesn't like. She hates being on the ranch. She basically got married to Curley because out of spite for her mother, because she thought her mother had taken a letter from her. So even if you do think jailbait or poison, remember, like I said in chapter 2, at this point, everything we know about Curley's wife has come from rumour or has come from the other male characters who are scared of losing her job because of her. Curley ain't been here, Candy said sourly. So this adverb is, again, it's another cruel one to put Curley's wife down. So he can't bring himself to be nice, Candy. Sourly. So sourly basically means miserably. Just can't bring himself to be nice to her. She stood in the doorway, smiling a little at them, rubbing the nails of one hand with the thumb and forefinger. She stood in the doorway is a character choice that Steinbeck is made. So think to yourself, she doesn't enter. So why doesn't she leave the doorway? So one possible reason could be that she's slightly anxious or slightly sort of scared or threatened by the fact that she's outnumbered 3-1. Even though she probably thinks she's above them, still the three men, maybe she thinks to herself, oh, I don't want to go in there. It's a bit of a tense situation. And the doorway gives her an easy exit if the conversation doesn't go too well. My personal opinion, and one that you may subscribe to, or you might think I'm talking a lot of nonsense, is I think the stable is a metaphor for the world of men. So where they are now, Crooks' stable is a metaphor for the world of men. She sees a house as a prison, and she only spends time there under Curley's rule. So Curley is like her warden. The stable is a metaphor for the world of men. Her house is a metaphor for prison. And the space between, so where she is now, the space in between is where she can freely do what she wants. She is under no one's rule. She likes to stand in the doorway to talk to men, because she goes in the stable, goes in the bunkhouse, or goes in wherever. She's not a part of that world because she's a female. So she stands in the doorway so she doesn't cross that boundary, as she's not a member of the world of men. John Steinbeck is showing she's not wanted there because the men are scared. So remember, a metaphor of the bunkhouse or the stable, that's the world of men. Her house is a prison. Everywhere in between is her domain. She can go there, she can do what she wants. And her eyes travelled from one face to another. So this basically means that she's given the men eye contact. So maybe she thinks that because she's an attractive woman, she can exert power over the men by looking them all directly in the eye. They left all the weak ones here, she said finally. Think I don't know where they went. So, that's an interesting point. She's basically, first of all, it's a criticism, isn't it? It's a put down by saying that, it's an insult by saying that they're below her, that they're weak men, which obviously the men, the guys wouldn't like. But also, it's ironic because it's debatable whether she knows it or not, but she's been left behind, which means she is one of the weak ones that she's grouped herself into. I would say that she probably does know it. That's why she's so depressed and so sad and so miserable, that she knows that she's seen as weak. So that could be personally or in a context-wise, it could mean just because of her gender. It's like I said, it's an insult to the three guys. What does it say about the marriage that her Curley, her husband, after 2 weeks, has gone to a prostitute? It would probably insinuate that they're probably not, they don't have sex. So that basically would say they probably, the romance has never really existed. And it's up to you whether you decide that she's come in as a predator or to be a sympathetic character. Okay, so funny thing, she said, if I catch one man and he's alone, I get along fine with him. But just let two of the guys to get together and you won't talk. Okay, so that shows maybe shows us the experience that she's done this before. Maybe she's tried this with other men. All men leave her alone. It might show us maybe experience that she's probably been in this position before she met, came to the ranch. Maybe she's talked to other men and other men have felt sort of threatened by her. After a pause, Crook says, maybe you better go along to your house now. We don't want no trouble. This is after she's basically said all the men are scared of each other. They're scared that men eat world, man eat man world after the American dream. That she thinks that all men are after one thing, all men are just after for what they can get. And then Crook says, maybe you better go along now to your house now. We don't want trouble. So you could either say he's saying this because he wants to get rid of her, or you could say wants her to go because actually she's hit a nerve, that actually the truth hurts and he doesn't want to think about that. He just wants to brush it underneath the carpet. So, well, I ain't giving you no trouble. Think I don't like to talk to somebody ever once in a while? Think I like to stick in that house all the time? So, two rhetorical questions in a row. Once in a while, question mark. House all the time, question mark. Is basically to try to get them to respond. And also get to the reader to think about it. To think about, by this point, all we've been told that she's a tart and she's promiscuous. By this time, we're beginning to see a different character. Another thing you could comment on is that of the characters, Curley's wife is the one that uses the most contractions, so shortened forms of the word, so ever, all the time. So she does it the most. And we could probably comment on this, that the contractions denote or infer a lack of education and also where she's from. So they're asked about Curley, they keep going on, and then she says, yeah, I've got a husband, you all see him, swell guy, ain't he? So obviously that's a sarcastic tone, but also shows us the first time what she really does think of Curley. Spends all his time saying what he's going to do to guys he don't like, and he don't like nobody. So we can imagine here, otherwise we're not shown, we can imagine here what her home life is like. We don't get to see the house, we don't get to see them having dinner, but if all their conversations are basically him saying who he's going to beat up, we can imagine that she's not fulfilled emotionally or in any way, that she's finding it boring. She's probably regretting the decision to leave her mother and to marry a guy that she doesn't know. Think I like to stick in that house all the time. Some think I don't like to talk to somebody ever once in a while. So this is done straight after Crook's talking to Lenny about needing to talk to someone. So this is done to make the reader think about her plight. At least the men are allowed to speak to each other at work, so all the men can speak to each other. If Curley had his way, his wife wouldn't talk to anyone. She paused, lost its sunniness and grew interested. So this is basically just showing us the depressed and moody state that she's in. Candy repeated suddenly, got it caught in her machine. All right, she said contemptuously. So this adverb is basically showing us the state she's in at the moment. She's in a terrible mood, and we think that maybe she's going to take it out on someone pretty soon. So here she says, what do I care? And then afterwards she says, what do you think I am? So repetition of questions again, based on what I've already told us about, that she's a questionable character. What do you think I am, a kid? So the last thing that Curley's wife wants to be viewed as is as a child. She wants to be viewed as an adult. So the fact that she's saying, what do you think I am, as a kid, basically shows the reader, or infers to the reader, that that's how really she knows they see her. So unfortunately, she probably knows that they see her as a kid. So she says, "You bindle bums think you're so damn good." So bindle basically means someone who hasn't got a home, like a hobo. So remember that a lot of these people like George and Lenny, they went from ranch to ranch and they really actually don't have a home. So it is actually a term meaning sort of a traveller, but obviously it's derogatory. Also, it's a bit of like a little kid name calling someone. So it's very childish behaviour and it's someone who's sort of like lashing out a little bit. And again, down here, she starts to sort of go again with the name calling, even worse, standing here talking to a bunch of bindle stiffs and nigger and a dum-dum and a lousy old sheep. I'm liking it because there ain't nobody else. So a massive quote there, because there ain't nobody else. She's so lonely that she knows that it's almost that she is with the weak ones, but she quite likes the fact that she's got a bit of power with them. And the fact here that she says, and what am I doing? She asking these questions, and because they're trying not to get in a conversation, she has to answer her own questions, which is a little bit sad. So down here, we got Candy saying, "You ain't wanted here. We told you, you ain't." So it's important that she's told that, as the other people recognise her as someone who will cause trouble. So it's important she's told that, as the other guys are telling her that she's going to cause trouble or she's going to throw a span in the works. So the pronoun of we, so we told you, that's important because it's shown it's not just one of them, it's the collective who thinks she's trouble, it's the collective, it's all of them who want her to go. So Curley's wife laughed at him after all that. "Baloney, I've seen too many of you guys." So even though she's young, she's got experience. Steinbeck's showing here that even young people have seen guys with their dreams fail. So even young, naive people realise that the American dream doesn't work. They've seen too many of these guys with their dreams fail and waste, and shows how hard life was in 1930s America. She relegates, Curley's wife relegates all the characters in this scene to other bums or other guys that she has seen. So it's important, if you talk about this in your controlled assessment, you can reference the American dream. That basically Steinbeck is saying that you're not gonna make your American dream. It's also ironic because she's not gonna achieve her dream. She doesn't realise that, but her dream of being an actress, she's basically criticising them and saying, "Oh, you're never ever gonna get your dream," but she's never gonna get her dream either. Okay, if you had two bits in the world, why'd you be getting two shots of corn with it and sucking the bottom of the glass? So basically they're saying that these men are never going to do what they're going to see through what they said they're going to do. All the men just waste their time or waste their money. I know you guys. So again, that shows your experience, but also it shows us how low opinion she has of men. So she doesn't really think very highly of men at all. "I might have knew," he said gently. "Maybe you just better go along and roll your hoop." So this shows how everyone perceives Curley's wife. So roll a hoop is basically an old kids game, old children's game, which I'll put on the screen now, which obviously like very young children. So this is a little bit of Candy getting his own back, that she wants to, he knows that she wants to be seen as an adult, but they only see Curley's wife as a child. Okay, so they're saying that they want her to go, and then she said, and she looked longest at Lenny until he dropped his eyes in embarrassment. So ask yourself why she's looking at Lenny. She's basically looking at Lenny for a little bit of support because she realised that he's the weakest one. He's the one that she can manipulate. So we go down a little bit. She's trying to get Lenny engaged in conversation. And then he's talking about rabbits, which she loves to do because he's Lenny. And she says, "Well, if that's all you want, I might get a couple of rabbits yourself." So this is her being flirtatious with Lenny. As sadly or laughably, this is Lenny's idea of American dream. Because although he wants the land, he only really wants the land for the rabbits. So she's actually getting Lenny a bit excited. And it's probably the weirdest chat-up line you're ever going to hear, but this is something that Lenny would really love. But the reader can see the danger and where this is going, that it's not going to end well whatsoever. So she turned on Crooks and Scorn. "Listen, nigger," she said, "you know what I can do if you open your trap." So here we really do see Curley's wife's vindictive side. She lets it linger as well. So she says, she calls him all this stuff. Then he stares at her. So she lets him, she almost lets him suffer from it. And it also shows that she knows that sort of Crooks, unfortunately, in those times, Crooks was at the bottom of the pile. So she lets it linger, and then she says, as well, keep your place then, nigger. I could get you strung up on a tree so easy, it ain't even funny. So a few things important on that. Keep your place is important. So that means beneath her, so in the ranch, keep your place beneath me, and in society, as obviously black men, unfortunately seen as sort of the lowest of the low back then. It's also a reference to lynching, which was very common at the time. So if you're not too sure what lynching is, it's basically if someone had done something wrong, particularly if a black man had done something wrong, a group of guys or group of men would go around and they would organize a lynch mob, and they would hang a guy normally from a tree. So obviously it was a punishment for whatever the man or the man had perceived to have done, but it was also they were hung up on a tree or hanged on a tree in sight as an example to the others. So this is Curley's wife really very much stamping her authority, and it's also making her feel herself good by making him feel pretty useless. So then we can see the sort of the effect of that. It says Crooks had reduced himself to nothing. There was no personality, no ego, nothing to arouse either like or dislike. He said yes ma'am, and his voice was toneless. So here we can basically see what Curley's wife has done to Crooks. So another thing, important thing to add about this is, this is actually not as harshly, but this is sort of what Crooks did to Lenny earlier on. When they're all out of the brothel, Crooks was pretty cruel, pretty mean to Lenny by saying, well, what would happen if George wouldn't come back? So what is important to note is that until Lenny fought back physically, Crooks was being pretty cruel to him. So Lenny's comeback in that situation was strength, or his physical strength. When Curley's wife was being criticised, her comeback was race. So she didn't have a comeback. Her comeback was race, that she could use Crooks' race against him. When Crooks is criticised or Crooks is attacked, he has no comeback. Even though he's an intelligent and a hard-working character, because he was black, or he is black, he has no comeback. So basically they're saying that, well, we could actually, we defend Crooks, we wouldn't let you do that. Curley subsided, so almost like Candy gives in and says, no, nobody was listening to us. So Candy here is defeated. He knows that she has the power. And again, this is the context, it's where they rank on the ranch. That basically they know, because Curley's wife is an attractive woman, that if she accused Crooks, of a black man, of touching her or raping her, they know it would only end one way. So she, another insight into their relationship here is, I'm glad you bust up Curley a little bit. He got it coming to him. Sometimes I like to bust him himself. So imagine this is someone who's been married for 2 weeks. So we can show the extent of their relationship, how dreadful their relationship is. She slips out, she goes out into the dark barn. So again, light is an important theme or important metaphor or symbol used throughout a novella. So basically we can say that she's the darkness again. So she's going to be the darkness that's going to block their light, that she's going to block their dreams, that the darkness, this darkness, is going to cause trouble. So as she went through the barn, the halter chains rattled and some horses snorted and stamped their feet. So basically this animal imagery is reflecting how the men feel. So it's almost like the men are snorting and stamping their feet. And also it's a metaphor for disruption, so how she's going to disrupt their lives. Candy says at the end, under this page, that bitch didn't all have said that to you. So obviously it's a really sort of insulting, derogatory term, but it's also the only other time that the word bitch is used in the novella is for Candy's dog. So again, we're seeing how they view Curley's wife, that she's also almost treated as an animal. In fact, earlier in the novella, when they're talking, the guys are talking about the prostitutes and the brothels, even the prostitutes are talked about more highly than Curley's wife. So that's an interesting point to maybe note in your controlled assessment, just where she ranks on the social or the popularity chain. Okay, so if we go to my notes page for chapter 4, like I said before, I would just basically scroll down, so pause at any point, And there's four pages of notes for this, so I will just flick between them. So pause at any point. Okay, that's it for chapter four. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you got a bit more information, bit more info on the underlying themes and the analysis and help for your controlled assessment. Thanks for listening. Hope you enjoyed it. And yeah, thanks again. Welcome to this final podcast on chapter five of Mice and Men, looking at Curley's wife. So in chapter five, this is unfortunately the chapter where Curley's wife dies at the hands of Lenny. It's important for a few reasons, but in this chapter, she is definitely painted in a different way than we've seen before. This chapter is just the two outsiders, Lenny and Curley's wife. Before this section, Curley's wife has put an act on the whole novella. In this section, we see why she acts like she acts. We see the depth of her loneliness, and we see her try to connect with a person. Unfortunately, she picks the wrong person. So, Curley's wife came around the last stool. She came very quietly so that Lenny didn't see her. So straight away, the adverb of quietly, we need to ask ourselves why she comes around quietly. So it's probably because if you go somewhere quietly, maybe it's because she doesn't want to be seen. So you could say this contrasts with her appearance. So we see that she's still wearing the bright cotton dress. She's wearing the red ostrich feathers on the mules. So the fact that she's walking in quietly contrasts with the fact that she's still wearing quite a loud and bright and garish outfit. She wore a bright cotton dress and the mules with the red ostrich feathers. So, this has been repeated throughout the novella. Wherever we see her, she wears this. This is almost like she's wearing a uniform. So a fireman would wear his something, a policeman wears their. Curley's wife seems to have a uniform of a cotton dress with the mules with the red ostrich feathers. She's wearing the cotton dress. We know what happens to things that Lenny touches, that he likes, that are soft. And we could even say that the warning signs are even louder now, the fact it's just them two in the chapter. She's still trying to look good even for Lenny, because she probably thinks, oh, she quite enjoyed talking to Lenny in the previous chapter, even though she didn't get much back. She noticed that he was the weakest one, the easiest one to manipulate. And also highlights the fact that she's so lonely and desperate for comfort, she's wearing her best clothes for the guy that is seen as the bottom of the social chain. You can also link it back to the context where maybe she's only got one outfit. Like, I imagine if you go out into town or go to a birthday party, you've got a particular outfit that you wear that you think you look good in. Well, that's the same with Curley's wife. She seems to think she looks good in this dress. Maybe she thinks it's the closest she looks to the movie idol that she wants to be. So again, we've got the red ostrich feathers. So everything that we talked about in chapter two, everything that the connotations with red are the same here. And I guess the red is also a warning sign that something is going to happen. So she said, "What you got there, sunny boy?" So this is her trying to be friendly. So it's a bit of a term of endearment, sunny boy. You could also maybe look at it the fact that it's a bit patronizing and condescending. So you probably wouldn't say sunny boy to someone that you respect. It's probably going to be someone you see is probably lower down than you. So it's probably a patronizing. Maybe she's trying to show Lenny that she's got the power. So she laughed, George giving you orders about everything. So she's sort of laughing, even though she's probably done it a bit more of a mean way. She's trying to feel comfortable in the conversation. So she said quietly, "Remember, I want you to talk about adverbs and Steinbeck's use of language in your controlled assessment." So she said quietly here. So this is a different side to her that we've seen before. So before, everything's been negative or harsh about her. But now Steinbeck is starting to use language that's a little bit softer, a little bit different to how we've seen her before. Also, It's almost like if you say something quietly to someone and there's just the two of you, it's almost like she's trying to have a little secret or a little secret moment with Lenny. She knelt in the hay beside him. "Listen," she says. So this is an imperative. So remember, we've talked about imperatives before, where we say it's almost like an order or command. So the use of the imperative here is almost like she's giving Lenny an instruction. So then she goes down here and says, "Why can't I talk to you? I never get to talk to nobody. I get awful lonely." So this is quite an important quote, and probably one that you should be using, or at least think about using in your controlled assessment. So again, it shows the depth of her loneliness and the situation that she's in. Well, somehow she's got herself in this situation where she's married to someone she doesn't like, she's on a ranch full of men that don't like her, and she's probably just realising what she has got herself into. If she could go back the clock and go back to her mum, or her old lady as she calls her, she probably regrets marrying Curley and would do anything to go back and see her mother. The use of the word awful as well, the use of the word, the adjective to describe how she feels, also shows the strength of feeling. So she doesn't just feel lonely, she's awful lonely. And again, lonely is repeated down here. So you could say that's a language feature to Steinbeck, or a technique that Steinbeck uses. So the repetition of the word lonely, and you could think to yourself, well, what is the significance of Steinbeck using those words so closely together? Also here, she says, "I never get to talk to nobody, I get awful lonely." So remember what we've talked about in the descriptive and the narrative and the creative writing, that you use short sentences for effect or for emphasis on a particular point. And this is what Steinbeck has done here. So, "Elsie get mad. How do you like not to talk to any?" So we've already talked about in the previous chapter the fact that she's a questionable character, and a lot of her dialogue are questions. But here she's using a rhetorical question, and for the first time, Lenny or someone actually responds to her. Normally when she's asked questions before, she gets no response. So she's maybe seeing here that she's making a bit of leeway with Lenny. "She consoled him. Don't you worry none. He was just a mutt." So this is basically saying that Lenny's told her that she's killed the dog, and she said she consoled him. So the use of the word consoled is interesting, as it's the first time we've seen Curley's wife as a sensitive person. This shows that she has an understanding side, that she's trying to reassure him that although the dog's dead, there'll be another dog coming soon. It also foreshadows her death in a way, and it's ironic. So she's basically telling Lenny, "Oh, don't worry that you've killed something, there'll be another one to replace it." And then in a couple of pages, or sort of 5 minutes' time, she's dead at the hands of Lenny. She has become a victim of Lenny. And maybe Steinbeck, or maybe society at the time, saying, well, if he dies, she'd just be replaced by someone else. This is also the first time that we sort of see a feminine side, or a motherly side, or a maternal side of her, that she knows that Lenny's upset, but she's trying to make him feel better. She moved closer to him and she spoke soothingly. So again, another adverb, and again, this is basically just leaning on from what I've just said before. This is another adverb, soothingly, the same point as consoled. So she's just trying to make him feel better. Soothingly, she's just trying to soothe him. She's just trying to make him feel better about the situation. So down here, when Lenny basically says that he's not allowed to talk to her because of George, she says her face grew angry. "What's the matter with me?" she cried. She doesn't really understand why people are interacting with her and not talking to her, and won't get in a conversation with her. She also doesn't really understand the connotations of her actions, and she doesn't really understand that how she addresses will get men into trouble, or how she got the jailbait tag. It's almost like, "What's the matter with me?" It's almost like she is a disease. And in some ways, she is. She's a married woman on a ranch that no one wants to interact with. She's not in a woman's world. On that ranch, she is in a man's world. So the word cry just tells her the strength of feeling, how strong she feels about it. Then Lenny says, "Well, George says you'll get us in a mess." So the interesting to note about that, more so about Lenny than Curley's wife, is he says, "George says." So it's not "you'll get us into a mess," or "I think you're getting us in a mess." It's "George says," which basically shows us more about Lenny, that he doesn't really know what's going on. All he's thinking is about the rabbits, that if he talks to her, he won't be able to get to feed the rabbits. He doesn't really understand too much why people were avoiding Curley's wife. So another big quote concerning Curley's wife is when she starts to talk about her dream. So she says, "I could have made something of myself," she said darkly. "Maybe I will yet." and then her words tumbled out in a passion of communication, as though she hurried before her listener could be taken away. So there's a few things I want to talk to you about that. One is straight away, it's just that we can get from her that there's a real bitterness that she hasn't achieved her dream or even gotten near to achieving her dream. Where it says, maybe I will yet, we could maybe infer from that that she thinks there's still a chance. You never know, she might show the people on the ranch that she is an actress or she could become an actress. So maybe I will yet could mean maybe that she doesn't think that the dream is over. And then her words tumbled out in a passion of communication. So if you think to yourself, you may be talking to your best friend who you haven't seen in a while and you had a particular problem in your life, this is what basically this means, is that she hasn't had anyone to speak to. This is all built up, and basically she's had it all bottled up, and then she's just let it all go from her. Maybe this is the first time also in the Vella that she's being herself. All before was an act, and this is when we're seeing the real Curley's wife. So where it says hurried before her listener could be taken away, this basically just shows her desperation of her need to communicate, that she's had so much bottled up and then she just needs to get it out. So like I said before, she's just putting on an act. In this section, we see why she acts the way she does and the depth of her loneliness, and that she's trying to connect with someone here. She's making a legitimate, believable attempt to connect with someone. Unfortunately, she's picked the wrong person. Also, quickly want to say, she said darkly. You could link this to the previous chapters where we've talked about that Curley's wife and her relationship of light and dark. So then Curley's wife says, talking more about the dream, I met one of the actors. He said I could go with that show, but my old lady wouldn't let me. First of all, this again shows how naive she is, her age. Naive meaning this is 99.9% would have just been someone that she met out in town, maybe just trying to get her into bed. It's basically just a chat-up line. There's a slight glimmer of hope that maybe he could have got into films, but we think nearly definitely the fact it's probably just a chat-up line. The fact that she calls her mother, she doesn't call her mum or dearest mother or mother, she calls her old lady, which isn't particularly respectful. So we could imagine that their relationship may be poor. It also tells us she doesn't talk about her folks or her dad, so we could probably say that maybe her dad has maybe moved away or the dad's not involved at all. So maybe that shows us that she hasn't had a positive or any male role model in her life. So perhaps if she did do that, she would have had someone there to maybe talk to her about how her dressing comes across, how her flirtatiousness, and why the men don't like it. So after all her talk about how she's feeling, that she was cried with anger, her face was angry. After her trying to console Lenny about his pup, after her telling him all about her dream about the actors, Lenny just says, we're going to have a place with the rabbits. So this shows that Lenny has absolutely no interest in anything but rabbits. And it's also sad in a way, because Lenny is built up as the most likeable character in novella. Even Lenny, who doesn't want to hurt anyone, who doesn't really know too much about what's going on, even Lenny cannot give Curley's wife sympathy. So basically that's showing us, showing the reader, or indicating the reader, that nobody cares about Curley's wife. So again, she starts talking about the guy she met who thought he could put us in pictures. He says he was going to put me in the movie, says I was a natural. Soon he get back to Hollywood, he was going to write. So the reader, even the Curley's wife, doesn't realise. The reader realised that this is a chat-up line. The fact that this guy, this man, has said she looks like an actress or could be an actress, that's why, from then on, Curley's wife has dressed how she's dressed. So some man has seen her and said, you look like an actress. So from then on, she's tried to almost repeat how she looked on that night. So I think in her head, she thinks to herself, someone might see me again and spot me and say, you're going to be going into the movies. And also, where it says gonna, so gonna put me in the movies is past tense. That's just showing us now that the dream has faded into nothing. She's waiting for the letter from the man who's chatted her up and given her dreams of the film stars. She says, thought my old lady stole it. Well, I wasn't going to stay no place where I couldn't get nowhere or make something of myself, and where they stole letters. So couldn't get in nowhere or make something of myself. So ironically, she's gone exactly that place because she's stuck on the ranch. She's almost saying there that she could have lived a life of freedom where she could express who she really was. instead of her under her mother's rule. But like I said, unfortunately, she's ended up just that place. It also just shows how naive she is, and actually how sad the situation, the predicament that she's got herself in. Then she says, well, I ain't told this to nobody before. Maybe I oughtn't to. I don't like Curley. He ain't a nice fella. So this is a pretty amazing thing for a wife, or a marriage of 2 weeks, for the wife to say, confiding in Lenny, because these are very personal things. She tells us what we already know, that she doesn't like Curley. But the fact that she knows it shows us why she's been avoiding him, why they're never around each other, and why she needs the attention so much. So he ain't a nice fella links back to the earlier quote where she's been talking about that Curley, all he does is talk about beating people up. So we can actually imagine, even though we're not allowed in, the Steinbeck doesn't allow us into their house, their household, we can imagine that they probably got a probably awful relationship, and also that he's probably got dreadful habits and traits, and he doesn't seem a very thoughtful or sensitive person whatsoever. It's also a massive thing to admit, and you've got to ask yourself why she confides in Lenny. So possible answers could be that she doesn't see him as a threat, and that she could probably deny it as a deniability there. So if Lenny actually went back and said something to George or any of the other guys, she could actually just deny it and say he's got the wrong end of the stick. And also, she probably knows that she's not going to get much of a response from him. He's almost a sounding board, where she's almost just listening to herself speak, just letting the words come out of her mouth. So then, sadly again, she says she confided in him. She moved closer to Lenny and sat beside him, she said. Could have been in the movies and had nice clothes, as they were. And I could have sat in them big hotels and had pictures. So one thing we must say about that is that it's all past tense. So had nice clothes, I coulda sat in them big hotels, and had. So all of them, past tense. So that's basically her admitting that she knows the dream is over, that her dream is ended, it's never going to happen. It's also a bit of a fantasy for her that she maybe, when she's so bored and so lonely, she probably drifts off to her, into her own little fantasy land. And it also shows the fact that she's not really accepting her new life on the ranch. She doesn't want to be a housewife, she sees herself as doing different things. It also shows, in a way, that she doesn't really know too much about being an actress. It is really a dream. There's no mention here about the craft of acting, that she really loves movies and it's her passion. All it basically is showing is that she craves attention. So instead of saying she wants to learn about the art of acting, she's basically saying she wants nice clothes, she wants to sit in a big hotel, and she wants people to take photos of her. All very superficial things. So the guy says it could have been a natural. So in a way, that's bordering on a cliche of a chat-up line. And she could also be saying, or Steinbeck could actually be saying, that she's not a natural, so is she unnatural? Something in her life is definitely unnatural. So then this bit's almost sort of humorous. She made a small grand gesture with her arm and hand to show that she could act. So she's trying to tell Lenny that she could have been this world famous or a fantastic actress. And the way she demonstrates this is doing a twirly little thing of her hand. Almost she's saying, oh, that's how great I am. I can do a little action with my hand. So again, with Curley's wife, the metaphor of light, the imagery of light is being used. So now the light was lifting as the sun went down. So remember, we said the sun and the light are metaphors for hope and dreams. So if the sun going down, we could say here that the sun or the hope and the dreams have ended on the hopes and dreams for Curley's wife, but also for Lenny. Even though Lenny's not talking at the moment, his dreams do end. Everyone's dreams end by the end of this chapter. As sun is the essence of life, sun is the essence of life. If the sun is going down, this could possibly say that this is foreshadowing the death of someone. So then again, all Lenny's interested in the rabbits, and she says angrily now, so the adverb of angrily, don't you think of nothing about those rabbits? So it's quite ironic in a way, because all she talks about is being an actress, while she's actually criticising Lenny for just talking about one thing, she does exactly the same. So this is just after Lenny has moved closer to her, because Lenny's enjoying the conversation a bit more. So this just shows that she's a little bit wary, she's a little bit of unsure, because remember, Lenny is a big, massive, bulking guy. So she's a little bit sure of this guy getting so close to her. So George says, I like to pet nice things with my fingers, soft things. So warning signs here for the reader. Curley's wife laughed at him. You're nuts, she said, but you're a kind and nice fella. just like a big baby. So here we can just see that Curley's wife is she's actually getting the attention that she desires, and she's really enjoying. Take Curley, his hair is just like wire, but mine is soft and fine because I brush it a lot. So here we see that she's quite vain just because she brushes her hair a lot, but also we see here the difference in hair is mirrors the difference in relationship or difference in personality than Curley and his wife. She sees Curley as someone hard, like wire, something that she doesn't really want to get involved with or have anything in common with, but she sees herself as soft and fine. So look at the difference between hair like wire and hair that is soft. So that's the difference that she's indicating there. She took Lenny's hand and put it on her head. Feel around there and see how soft it is. So obviously this is unknowingly a bad idea, and there's massive warning signs with the reader that we probably know this is only going one way. So Lenny said, oh, that's nice, and he stroked harder. Again, stroked harder is telling us this is going wrong, this is only going to end one way. Warning sign to the reader. So this is, here's the description of Lenny grabbing her trying to get away. Okay, she continued to struggle and her eyes were wild with terror. He shook her then and he was angry with her. Don't you go yelling, he said. And he shook her and her body flopped like a fish. And then she was still, for Lenny had broken her neck. So I remember the first time I read that is pretty a hard-hitting description of Curley's wife's death. So flop like a fish, broken her neck. It's very powerful, very graphic. Unfortunately, she ends like she starts the novella. She ends as a victim. It describes her terror and it shows that she is powerless in death, but also the fact that she was powerless in society. I remember, like I said, revert to context. She's powerless in society and she was also powerless on the ranch. And it's also, Steinbeck uses a simile here. So remember a comparison, her body flopped like a fish. So she's comparing it to a fish, that's a simile. Curley's wife lay with a half covering of yellow, and the meanness and the planning and the discontent and the ache for attention were all gone from her face. She was very pretty and simple, and her face was sweet and young. First of all, we can see that Lenny has done exactly the same as what he did with the puppy. So when the puppy died, to try to hide the puppy from people's sight, he covered the puppy in yellow hay. So again, we are getting the analogy of Curley's wife is being treated like an animal. So before we say that Cole's the only time that the word bitch was used was to describe Candy's dog. Again, this is her being almost mentioned on the same level as a dog, that he's trying to cover Curley's wife up like he tried to cover the dog up. But also, yellow hay. So yellow could almost be sort of the connotations are light and heavenly. So straight away, Steinbeck is showing us that in death, that she's almost like an angel. So, and the meanness and the plannings and the discontent and the ache for attention were all gone from her face. She was pretty and simple and her face was sweet and young. So, interesting to say, this is free from all negativity. So before, Curley's wife is pretty much described as negative throughout. In death, all that, she is free from negativity. So basically, Steinbeck could be saying here that everything, all the craving for attention, all the meanness that she gave, all the meanness to her, every time that she was victimized, every time she was criticized, all of that is gone. So Steinbeck is suggesting here that maybe she is actually better off now, that she's actually better off, that she's passed away. She was very pretty. So this is actually the nicest thing that's ever been said about Curley's wife. And it's in death. So make of that what you will. It's also important, this section is actually important, because throughout the novel, all the characters are spoken of in a pretty disgusting, very negative way. So it's important that our invisible narrator says this, that we know, so we know who she is, that we actually know, the reader knows that underneath it all, underneath all the makeup, all underneath all the attention, all the craving for the flirting, it's important to know that she is a nice person, that she's an innocent person, despite what all the men are telling us. Now her rouged cheeks and her reddened lips made her seem alive and sleeping very lightly. The curls, tiny sausages, were spread, sleeping very lightly. So again, her face was sweet and young, sleeping very lightly. It's almost like she's sort of like a Walt Disney sort of princess, or that she's become an angel. So as well as Steinbeck saying that maybe she's better off dead, that this place is no place for a woman, he could have also been maybe saying that Perhaps if she would have just been herself, so she hadn't been craving for attention, if she hadn't been flirting with the men, if she hadn't been putting all the makeup on, if she'd just been herself, a normal person, then maybe she would have been happier. So another quote that I haven't actually got on this extract, but I have got on my notes, and I may have a picture of it, I'm not sure, is a quote. And the quote is from the invisible narrator, and it's, "As sometimes happens, a moment settled and hovered and remained for much more than a moment. And sound stopped and movement stopped for much, much more than a moment." So this is almost Steinbeck giving a prayer for her. Because none of the men are going to give a prayer for her, this is the narrator doing it. It's that space or moment where someone should have said something, one of the men should have said something or done something, but they didn't do it. So this is the narrator giving her her moment. Also, this is the moment where everything changes and everyone's dream dies. George and Lenny aren't going to get the house. Curly's wife is not going to be an actress. Candy's not going to get off the ranch. There is no one on this ranch that is not affected by her death. So then Candy says, "You goddamn tramp, you done it, didn't you?" So this shows that everyone knew this would end badly because of her. It also shows his prejudice. The prejudice against her just comes pouring out. There's no eulogies, there's no him saying, "Oh, well, she was a nice person." It's not very respectful. Also where it says, "gradually his sorrow," this really means his sorrow. So he's not sad for her, he's sad for himself. It's also important to note that when Curley comes in, he's not emotional, he's not actually sad about Curley's wife. He doesn't seem to be particularly upset about it. He just wants to get revenge. So it might not be revenge for Curly's wife's death. It might be revenge because Lenny broke his hand or did something to his hand and he wants revenge for that. So the last quote I want us to look at, and I'll try to put another picture of this as I speak, is actually two more quotes, is, "Then gradually time awakened again and moved sluggishly on." So here Steinbeck uses personification. So remember, that's giving an inanimate object human emotions. So this image suggests that time doesn't stand still. Time goes on. Life goes on. So what Steinbeck is saying is their dreams have ended, but life still goes on. However, the use of the adverb sluggishly suggests that life will still go on, but without dreams, it will be a painful existence, that without dreams, it's almost not worth carrying on. The last quote I want us to look at is straight after Curly's wife's death, and it says, Around the last stall came a shepherd bitch, lean and long, with heavy hanging dugs. The quote I want us to look at is, halfway to the packing box where the puppies were, she caught the dead scent of Curly's wife, and the hair rose along her spine. She whimpered and cringed to the packing box and jumped in among the puppies. So this is straight after a death and the dog walks in. So it's another animal reference. A lot of animal references are used throughout the novella. And it is almost saying, Steinbeck is saying, that almost humans should follow animal behaviour. That the only person who felt sad for a death was the dog. Lenny, all Lenny was bothered about was that he'd done something wrong, he wouldn't be able to feed the rabbits. All George was worried about that he could find Lenny before the lynch mob got to him. All Curley was worried about was that he wanted to get revenge. All Candy was worried about was that the dream of his house was over. So the only person who cared, who cried or whimpered for Curley's wife was the dog. So again, that shows us where the society placed her, but where the men placed her as well. Okay, so very my notes pages is page one. So like I've said lots of times, just pause if you want to look at some notes, just write down what you think is applicable, what's going to be useful to you. Okay, that's it. So here are the quotes down here that I talked about towards the end that you don't have in your extracts. So thanks very much for listening to the podcast. Hope it's been informative. Hope it hasn't been too miserable. Hope you got some bit of revision, a few tips. And I hope you all do well in your controlled assessments.